Thank you, Pastor Turner.
Amen.
I have really felt privileged to be here this week. I love your pastor, Pastor Turner. And through him, I've gotten to meet some of the other pastors. And I have just grown to appreciate the fellowship you folks have. And that music, I tell you what, I mean, I wish I could take that home with me. I have really enjoyed our fellowship and our worship as we spent time together here on these nights. We've been going through a section of scripture that was written by our Lord himself. It's the only thing Jesus ever wrote. He taught, and others wrote what he taught. But these are letters dictated by Jesus. And he authored these letters. John wrote them and put them in the book of Revelation. But Jesus authored these letters.
Wow.
But these are important letters to understand. And the fact that the cities are in a geographical circle, starting at Ephesus, going to Smyrna, then Pergamum and Thyatira, and around to Sardis, and then down to Philadelphia and Laodicea, it goes in a big circle. And that geographical circle kind of tells us that there is a circle of ideas. We call it a cycle. And it's a cycle of lost love. He begins in Ephesus by saying, I've got something against you. You lost your first love. And the first love is where the person, the other person, is everything to you. You can't think of anything else but that person. That's first love. And it's crazy love, you know. And you kind of do things and think things like you never would do before because you're kind of lost in the love.
Yeah.
And he says, that's the way you used to be with me, Jesus says.
Wow.
And he says to that church, you're very orthodox and you're very, very committed to ministry. Good church. But they didn't have the passion anymore. Mm. Passion was gone. And then you go to, you know, to Smyrna, and it's hard times, and we all have hard times in our relationships. And those hard times can kind of draw you back and say, hey, we got to get back to the first love. And if you do, that's good. But if you don't, then you go on to Pergamum, because that's where you begin to really lose it. Mm. You've had some problems, and in our walk with the Lord, we have difficulties, we have problems, things happen, and we start to get critical of Jesus. Why didn't you help me on this?
Mm.
And you begin to think of other things. You begin to be more enticed to the world. Which James tells us in chapter 4, verse 4, is the other lover. You adulterers and adulteresses, don't you know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. The world is the other lover. And every time we have a love affair with the world and its system, we are committing spiritual adultery. That's a serious word. And that's what happens in Pergamum. But you know what Pergamum is all about? It's just about false teaching. The doctrine of Balaam and the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. It's just ideas. It's all happening in the head. They haven't done anything wrong yet. They're just thinking about it. And when that happens, when you start thinking about it, you're on the way to doing it. And that's what happens when you come down in the circle to Thyatira, and they're guilty of fornication and adultery. They thought about it in Pergamum, and they're doing it in Thyatira. And that goes on, and pretty soon the relationship is dead. And that's what happened in Sardis. He said, you got a name that you live, but you're dead. And our relationship with Christ can be that way. We can get so wrapped up in the world that we really don't have time for Jesus anymore. He doesn't excite us anymore. Getting into the Word doesn't, you know, isn't important to us anymore. And the relationship is all but dead. Dead. And that's the cycle of lost love. And the next two are counseling sessions. It's all about doors. And Jesus has a door in Philadelphia. He says, I open a door and nobody can shut it. He's open. He's reconcilable. Come back to me. My door is open, he says.
Yeah.
But in Laodicea, that rich church that thought they didn't need anything, he said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. Let me back in. a knock.
Yes, sir.
And that door is the door that we open. The handle's on the inside. And Jesus is saying, let me back in. Now that's the cycle of lost love we've been looking at. And so we decided to stick on Pergamum because that's where it all changes. That's where you go from going north to starting to go south. You were going up, but now you're going down.
Right.
And that's where it happens in the mind. And so we play mind games with God. And when that happens, we're on dangerous territory. And so last night we looked at the first problem they had with their mind, and that was the doctrine of Balaam. And the idea of Balaam was that, well, he taught Balak how to get God to curse his people. God wouldn't curse his people. Balaam tried three times. God wouldn't do it. But then Balaam gave counsel to Balak.
Yeah.
And we read in the book of Numbers that his counsel was, Balak, if you get your ladies to dress seductively, go down and around the camp of Israel and have a party and draw the men out. And man, that's exactly what happened. And they were going to find their fulfillment. They've been hanging around in the camp there. They're bored. They don't know what to do because they're waiting for God to take them across the Jordan River into what he promised them as the promised land. They were on the verge of greatness. And God said, I'm going to take you in. Just be patient. Delayed gratification. Come on, just be patient.
Wow.
And they decided that they were going to have their fulfillment on the wrong side of the Jordan. And 24,000 Israelis lost their lives. The plague of God. That's the doctrine of Balaam. Telling you that you can find, Jesus can be your religion, but you'll find your fulfillment in the world. And that's the kind of thinking that'll kill you. Kill your spiritual walk with Jesus. It'll kill your church. So it's all about finding fulfillment. Now, there's one other doctrine. They have the doctrine of Balaam. Some are holding that doctrine in Church of Pergamum. And he says, but you also have some there that are holding the doctrine of the Nicolaitans.
Yeah.
This is a little different than finding your fulfillment in the world. This is all about finding your authority in the world.
Oh,
your authority. You ever had bad advice? Oh, I've had people give me bad advice, you know, and I look back and say, well, I wish I hadn't listened to them. Bad advice can hurt you. Even bad advice from church leaders. That happens. Yeah, churches. The American church has been receiving bad advice for decades now. As religious gurus have come up with all sorts of ways to modify the church and make it more acceptable to the world.
Lord,
as a result, the church has become anemic as everyone tries to mimic the latest fad in ministry and church growth. But you know, something dramatic has happened as a result of that. The church has become more like the world, but it has lost its spiritual power. That's what Paul told Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 5. They have a form of godliness, but they deny the power thereof. You can look religious, you can act religious, you can go to church, and you can have a great time. You can sing the songs, but if you're not walking with Jesus, the power is not there. And that's the message here of the Nicolaitans. You know, life is a maze. Constant decisions on which way to turn. And how do you know? So, who are the Nicolaitans? You're looking at your notes there. It's a form of godliness, but no power of God. Nobody knows exactly who these people are, so how do we understand what Christ is saying now? We're going to look at the Nicolaitans. The folly of listening to the world. So many voices, so little wisdom. You know what the problem is? We don't think like God. Our natural thinking is worldly thinking. So we need God to tell us how to think. That's why His Word is so important. Isaiah 55, God says, your thoughts are not my thoughts, my ways are not your ways. For the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. God's saying, you don't think like me, but you need to. So how are you going to begin to think like me? You listen to my word, and you'll begin to think like me. Learning to make wise decisions in the Lord. Spiritual realities always are more important than the physical illusions around us. And so this is important to understand. So, as we begin to look at this part of the Pergamum letter, let me read the Pergamum letter again. Revelation chapter 2, verses 12 to 17. I'm going to read out of the English Standard Version tonight. You just follow along whatever version you have. Revelation 2, beginning in verse 12. And to the angel of the church in Pergamum write, the words of him who has the sharp two-edged sword. I know where you dwell, where Satan's throne is. You hold fast my name, and you did not deny my faith, even in the days of Annas, my faithful witness, who was killed among you where Satan dwells. But I have a few things against you. You have some there who hold the teaching of Balaam, who taught Balak to put a stumbling block before the sons of Israel, so that they might eat food sacrificed to idols and practice sexual immorality. So also you have some who hold the teaching of the Nicolaitans. Therefore repent. If not, I will come to you soon and war against them with the sword of my mouth. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who conquers, I will give some of the hidden manna, and I will give him a white stone and a new name written in the stone that no one knows except the one who receives it. What a letter he wrote to this church. Now, it's all about the wrong thinking. He wanted them to have a pure mind, and they had some who taught the doctrine of Balaam and some who taught the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. They were tolerating bad ideas in the church. That was their problem. So you have two doctrines. But then you come to the end and you notice there are two promises. If you'll overcome, I'll give you either manna, you know, the manna, hidden manna to eat, and I'll give you a white stone. All right. Now there are two promises because there are two false ideas. And if they overcome each of them, they'll have the two promises. So overcome the doctrine of Balaam, I'll give you the hidden manna. We talked about that last night. Oh, what a trick that is. What an amazing thing. The hidden manna. Not the manna that was all over the ground, but the manna that was taken and put in a golden pot and put in the Ark of the Covenant with the mercy seat over it in the Holy of Holies of the tabernacle, within the courtyard of the tabernacle, within the center of the camp. And there's the manna that was hidden manna. And it's eating the manna, which is, Jesus said in John chapter 6, I am the bread of life. As Moses gave you manna, my Father has given me to you to eat. We feast on Jesus. We spend our time with Jesus. We absorb Jesus. And that's eating the manna. But the hidden manna is eating it in the very presence of God, in the holy place. And that's a very special thing. Now, the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, there's one more promise. I'll give you a white stone. So, page 2 of your notes, concern number 2, the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. And the illusion is so many voices, so little wisdom, and that we can find our authority in the world. And so much of the church today is looking for its answers in the fads of the world, the wisdom of the world. Yeah. And so many Christians are following along with that and trying to find their authority in the world.
Okay.
You know, we say, well, the Bible says God created the heavens and the earth. But science says it was all by evolution. So what are you going to believe? You know, what are you going to believe? You got two ideas. The world's wisdom, evolution, or God's wisdom, creation. We have that kind of alternative when we come to the things of the world. Morality, it's all about self-fulfillment. But when you read the word, Jesus said, if a person will come after me, let him deny himself. It's about self-sacrifice, not self-fulfillment. Who are you going to believe? What's your authority? Who are you listening to? So the main idea is Jesus Christ is totally sufficient for every need in our lives. Personal fulfillment, eating the hidden manna, and personal direction, the white stone. Years ago, it's been a long time now, when my wife and I courted. We're going to celebrate 53 years of marriage this year. Now, that's a long time. And we're having as much fun now as we ever had. And we had dated for a number of years, and one night we were out walking. It was a moonlit night, and it was on the edge of town, you know, and we were walking out along a country road, and we stopped, and we were talking, and that's where I proposed to her. Well, the next day, we went back over there to see where it was, because it was dark. See where it was, I proposed to her. And it was right at the entrance to the city dump. So since then, my wife's been saying, I got my husband at the dump. Well, I didn't have enough money for a ring then. We'd gone and looked at rings, and she picked out one that was just special. And so I was putting money on it, you know, and finally I got enough. And it was a very special night. My wife was in nursing school, and there was a banquet they had every year. It was in Chicago. And it was called the Florence Nightingale Banquet. And so we're going to go to the banquet. And that night, I secretly had picked up the ring. And we went out and drove out before the banquet out to where the planetarium is in Chicago. And you look back and you can see the whole skyline of Chicago. It's a beautiful setting. And I thought, that's a perfect setting to give her the ring. And I gave her the ring, and it was, you know, just a wonderful time. We went to the banquet, and she walked around like this. You know, and, and it was just a great time. But you know, that night we had dinner and a diamond. And that's what Jesus is offering to you. Dinner and a diamond. The hidden manna and the white stone. Jesus Christ is totally sufficient for every need of our life. Page 3 in your notes, let's talk about the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. It's a seductive lie. John 8, John says that Satan is a liar, the father of lies.
Amen.
And he started out in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve, and he challenged God. Has God really said you can't eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? And Eve thought about it, and she said, well, yeah, God has said that. And Satan said, well, he's just trying to keep the good stuff from you. And so he began to fool with her mind. She got that in her mind, and then she sinned and had her husband sin, and that's been a problem ever since. It all began with a lie.
Yeah.
God's trying to keep it from you. The seductive lie that wisdom for life is to be found in this world. Now, when it says some hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, that's a puzzle. I mean, you pastors, if you've ever studied this, you're like me. You know, what in the world is the Nicolaitan? And the commentaries don't help you, right?
All right.
They think it's a sect derived from Gnosticism, or maybe the followers of Nicholas, who was one of the deacons mentioned in Acts 6, or a sect using his name, or maybe it's an unknown Nicholas and somebody following him, and they're all speculating.
All right.
And I want to give you a couple of observations. Notice, first of all, this is very important to Christ. In the first letter to Ephesus, he says, this know that I hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans. So he was talking about it to Ephesus. Now you get on to Pergamum, the third letter, and he says, the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which thing I hate. Now, our Lord's pretty strong about this, and I don't think the Pergamum church or the Ephesus church had any confusion about what the doctrine of the Nicolaitan was. Because he doesn't describe it, he doesn't give you a definition, doesn't tell you where it came from, he just says, I hate it, and they knew exactly what he hated.
All right.
So therefore, it's not an obscure sect. This is something that they knew well, and it's an ism, Nicolaitanism. It's a thought. Number two, God's Word's its own interpreter. This is not immersed in forgotten histories and archaeological ruins somewhere. You know, look more closely at what's happening in the text. What clues do we have as to what he's talking about?
All right.
Number three, names are significant. Last night I was telling you that the name Balaam comes from Balaam. That's a Hebrew word. Balaam means devourer. Am is the word for people. So Balaam is devourer of the people. And the people of Israel were devoured by their indulgences in the doctrine of Balaam. Mm-hmm. He's the devourer of the people. Well, Nicolaitan, it means Nikao, to conquer, and Laos, which is people. This is a Greek name. The other was a Hebrew name. This is a Greek name. Nikolaos, Nicholas, conqueror of the people. This isn't the idea of devouring them with seductive lies to get them involved in all sorts of things. This is, you know, this is conquering them. That is making them subservient to them. This is the idea of overlording. This is the whole idea of authority structure, conquering their minds, conquering their church. That's what it means. Nicolaitanism is simply subjugating the people, lording it over the people, replacing Christ's wisdom with man's wisdom. Beginning of the distinction between the clergy and the laity, and the clergy are so much nearer to God. The laity, well, they just hang there and depend on our words. That's Nicolaitanism. And this is illusion. The wisdom and authority of this world is more important than the wisdom and authority of Christ and His Word. That seems kind of silly to us who love the Lord, but folks, it's happening all the time, even in the church. We've bought into the illusion. Can I have you look at another passage? Let me give you an illustration of this. It's in John chapter 7. And this is after Jesus fed the 5,000, and he said that he's the bread of life, and that was our discussion last night, and how we eat of the hidden manna. Well, in John 7, the very next chapter, it's the Feast of Tabernacles. And everybody's going to go to Jerusalem to celebrate the Feast of Tabernacles. And Jesus and his family are up in Galilee. That's where Nazareth was. And so it says in John 7, verse 1, after these things, Jesus walked in Galilee, for he would not walk in Judea, because the Jews sought to kill him. Now the Jews' Feast of Tabernacles was at hand. And his brethren, therefore said unto him, depart from here and go into Judea, that your disciples also may see the works that you do. For there is no man that does anything in secret. He himself seeks to be known openly. If you do these things, show yourself to the world. Then it says, for neither did his brothers believe in him. Then Jesus said in verse 6 unto them, my time is not yet come, but your time's always ready. The world cannot hate you, but it hates me, because I testify of it, that its works are evil. Mm-hmm. And he says in verses 8 and 9, well, you go on up to this feast. I'm staying back. In verse 10, he says, when his brethren were gone, then he went also to the feast, not openly, but as it were in secret.
Right.
Now notice what's happening here. What are his brethren saying to him? What's their idea for Jesus? Well, if you want people to believe you're the Messiah, then you've got to get out there and show them what you got. Put on a show. Advertise yourself. Get a PR agent. Hold a town hall meeting. You know, get important people to sponsor you. Come on, Jesus. You need to have a plan here to go down there, and then they'll believe you're the Messiah. That's the way the world does it. That's what his brethren were depending on. You got to have a PR agent. But Jesus didn't think that way.
All right.
He wasn't about to go and plaster himself on a billboard. He wasn't doing it that way. He was looking for the power of the Spirit in his life.
Yeah.
He was even doing it in secret so it wouldn't be given credit to the world. It would be all of God or nothing. And that was his way. And Pergamum's like that. They're thinking like Jesus' brethren. And then it says, neither did his brethren believe in him. And that's the seeds of Nicolaitanism that were sown in this church. You know, this is a distancing of the people from a direct relationship with Christ. You can't go to Jesus directly anymore. You must go through an intermediary, authoritative figure, a priest, a church. Got to go to the confessional. Confess your sins to the priest and he'll confess them to Christ. You can't go to Jesus. You're just a common person. That's Nicolaitanism. Lording it over the people. Yeah. Conquering the people.
Wow.
I heard an evangelical pastor say, people can't understand their Bibles. They need professionals to explain it to them. I said, really? John 3:16, God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son.
Yeah.
Whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. What don't you know about that? What don't you understand about that?
Yeah. Yeah.
You can understand the word. I mean, there are places where it gets a little tough. But the message is clear. You can understand it. Don't let anybody take the Bible away from you. Well, that's what they were doing. They were depending on worldly methods to accomplish spiritual ends. And Jesus said, I'm not doing it that way. Let me give you a little bit of history. Page 4. I don't want to bore you, you know, but I want to tell you a little history here. You okay with this? All right. Otherwise, go to sleep. I'll wake you up in a little bit, you know. We'll be okay. All right. The early church. Ephesus was the first church he addressed in the seven churches, right?
Right.
And he says, your love has diminished. Will you go back and study the Ephesian church when Paul founded that church in the book of Acts? And in chapter 19, he had been there for 3 years. I mean, that was the longest time he ever spent anywhere. He was in Ephesus. And Paul was a rather outward person, you know. He didn't mince the words. And he was a bold and courageous witness of Jesus. And so he's out there and he's telling people about Jesus. And one of the merchants got really angry at him. His name was Demetrius, and he was a silversmith, and he was making silver statues to the goddess Diana, and that was the big goddess of Ephesus. And he got all the people stirred up, and the people then began to riot, and they began to chant, great is Diana of the Ephesians, you know, and they were trying to drown Paul out. And then he got them all to go to the theater. And that theater, you can go there today and see the ruins of the theater, and it's an amazing place. It holds over 20,000 people. And they were filled there, and it says they began to chant, great is Diana of the Ephesians, over and over. Great is Diana of the Ephesians. Great is Diana of the Ephesians. I mean, I said it twice and you're bored already. They did it for 2 hours. And you read in chapter 19 of Acts in verse 30, and it says, Paul would have entered in unto the people. Paul looks at this, 20,000 people gathered in one place. Wow, what a place to witness. Let me in. Paul's the kind of guy that walks into a burning building and lights matches. I mean, he's not afraid of anything. He's going to walk in there and do this. And it says in verse 30 right after that, and the people... the disciples permitted him not. Certain of the chief of Asia who were his friends sent unto him, beseeching him that he would not venture into the theater. Paul didn't care about his life.
All right.
He cared about Jesus.
All right.
And he's going to put his life on the line.
All right.
And they stopped him.
All right. All right.
And then the church clerk stands up in verse 35 and he quiets the people and he says, hey, there's not a problem here, you know. Demetrius, he's okay. He's going to keep going. He's got a business. He's going to keep his business. And Paul, he's not really bothering us. So, hey, let's not be rash here. And it says that the church accepted the advice of the town clerk. They took the wisdom of the world instead of the wisdom of God. And it was right after that that Paul left Ephesus. My ministry's done here. You're not going to give me the freedom to walk into dangerous situations. I'm done. And he left. And it's just a little while later that Paul writes the words of Jesus, "I have something against you. You've lost your first love."
Wow.
That's what happened in Ephesus. They finally came around. They said, "Oh, wow." Jesus said, "You hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans." That's the idea, the subjugation of the people. 3 John chapter 9, verse 11, Paul or John was an elder in the church of Ephesus. And there was a man there, his name was Diotrephes, and he was trying to make himself important, you know, and he wanted everybody to follow him. And you can read it in 3 John, verses 9 to 11. And he was a bad man, but he was pretending to be the good man. And he was getting everybody to follow him. And John says, "Diotrephes, beware of Diotrephes." He loves to have the preeminence among the people. Listen, folks, none of us deserve the preeminence.
Amen.
Only Jesus enjoys the preeminence. And then in Revelation 2 and verse 6, they came to hate the Nicolaitans. That's what happened in the church in Ephesus, in the Pergamum church. Revelation 2 to 15, Christ's written letter to the apostle. A letter written by the Apostle John, the church was tolerating worldly wisdom as a significant influence on their lives. And instead of hating it, like Ephesus, says, "You have them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans." Mm-hmm. They're beginning to buy into the idea that there's a spiritual elite. All the rest of us have to fit into the system. That was the way it was in the first 200 years of the church. Steady erosion of biblical authority in favor of ecclesiastical authority based on worldly wisdom. Power struggles, politics, and pride in the church. The church was being persecuted. Well, the last of the Roman empires that was a great persecutor was Diocletian. And when Diocletian died, there was a great fight over the throne, and on one side you had Constantine in the west, on the other side you had Maxentius and Lucinus on the east, and they were both trying to become emperor after Diocletian, so they decided to fight it out. And there was a bridge over a little river up in northern Italy, and the Milvian Bridge, and so they're bivouacked on either side of the river, and they're going to have a big fight the next day. And so Constantine goes out, and he looks up in the sky, and he sees a cross burning in his mind. He has a vision of this, and a sign, "By this sign conquer." And so he prays this little prayer, "Oh God, if you let me win and become the emperor, then I'll honor you." And so he had crosses put on the shields of all of his army guys. And the next day they went into battle, and Constantine won. So he decided to Christianize the Roman Empire. And when he did that, he awarded himself the title Pontifex Maximus, the maximum pope. And that's what the Roman political leaders had that title for a while. 65 years later, he sat on a golden throne, by the way, as the honorary president of the highest assemblies of the church, and now politics was running the church. And then a guy by the name of Bishop Damasus came on the scene, and the emperor that succeeded after Constantine was Gratian, and he refused to take the pontificate and pontifex attire and all of that, and so it was conferred upon the bishop of Rome for the first time, and that was Bishop Damasus, and that's when the papacy began in Rome with the church. And he started wearing all this funny stuff with the peaked hats and all the garb and all that stuff. That's when it happened. Right there in 378 AD. And so Christianity became fully integrated with the world system. Became very political and very controlling. And the result was ecclesiastical authority replaced biblical authority. Tradition superseded scripture, and worldly wisdom saturated the church's thinking. The wisdom of men began to replace the wisdom of Christ. But then, a number of centuries later, you know, you had the Reformation. Page 5 of your notes, the Reformation, 16th century, the 1500s. And there were men that began to reason and say, you know what? The people need to have the scriptures. We can't have this authority over us by the political system and the ecclesiastical system. And so guys like John Huss in Bohemia, who translated the Bible into Czech for the Czech people, and Martin Luther, who translated the Bible into German for the German people, and John Wycliffe, who translated the Bible into English for the English people, and William Tyndale, who really made a wonderful translation out of the Greek and Hebrew into the English, and all of them were killed for what they did.
Yeah.
The ecclesiastical authority didn't want the people to have the Bible. It was Nicolaitanism. The subjugation of the people. And the wisdom of Christ began to replace the wisdom of men again.
All right.
They brought the Reformation, they brought the people back to the Word.
Yes, sir.
Martin Luther said at the Diet of Worms, which was the council that condemned him, and said, hey, don't give me tradition, give me scripture. And they had no scripture for what they were teaching.
Right.
And he said, tradition doesn't trump scripture. This Nicolaitan idea that the worldly wisdom is really what you need is bogus. And so it all kind of returned. And now we come into our modern age, the modern church. And worldly wisdom once again is beginning to overtake the church. All the systems and the important people telling the church what to think and what to believe. Let me give you a couple of ideas about that, the 21st century phenomenon. Executive management. That's what they say the church needs. Executive, CEOs. Okay. I was at a leadership seminar in Orlando. And it was put on in a Baptist church. And the pastor of that church was the signature speaker at that conference. Others spoke, but he was the main man. And he gave a whole discourse on leadership to the pastors that came to this conference. And in that discourse, he said, you know, my idol of leadership, I've got a picture in my office I look at all the time, and that's my idol of leadership. And I'm thinking, wow, he's got a big picture of Jesus in his office. And then he said, that picture is a picture of General Douglas MacArthur. And my heart just dropped right down my feet. Oh my goodness, man, you don't understand. He was bringing the worldly picture of leadership into it. You got to be a tough guy. You got to order the people around. You can't take any guff. This is a pastor that carried a gun. And I thought, oh my goodness, I'm not patterning my life after this guy. And yet pastors all over thought he was the greatest. Wow. You know, Luke chapter 22, the disciples are arguing, and they want to be one of the want to know who's going to be the biggest in the kingdom, and they're arguing about that. And Jesus said unto them in Luke 22, verse 25, the kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and they that exercise authority upon them are called benefactors. See, that's what the world does. They want to be the Lord over everybody, and they want everybody to look at them like, you owe me, you know, benefactors, you know, you owe me. So they're indebted to the leadership. And Jesus in the next verse says, but don't you be like that.
Yeah.
Don't be so. But he that is greatest among you, let him be as the younger. He that is chief, as he that doth serve. For which is greater, he that dines or he that serves? Is not he that dines? Who is better, the butler or the master who sits at the table, or the butler who serves him? And Jesus said, but I am among you as the butler.
Amen.
I'm among you as he that doth serve. That's a picture of leadership.
Yeah.
And what Jesus does, he takes our organizational charts, you know, where the pastor's on the top, you know, and then you got all the other figures, the deacons and all that, you know, and then you come down to just the ordinary people in the leaders. He takes that chart and he turns it right upside down. That the more authority you have, the more people you serve.
Yeah.
You see, we bought into the Nicolaitan idea.
Wow.
Business and finance. I watch some of these on the television. My office is still down off of the campus of the Holy Land Experience. That's where the Scriptorium Center for Biblical Antiquities is. And we sold that facility to Trinity Broadcasting Network Charismatic Group, and they've turned it into a charismatic situation. But whatever I may think about their charismatic excesses, I watch these guys, and they're on television, they're the big guys, they're on TV, and I watch them raise money, and they're frauds. Man, they're milking the people. They're telling the little old ladies that don't have much, even if you don't have it, write a check, because you're sowing seed money, and God's going to bless you tenfold if you send in your money. I mean, they're getting thousands of dollars, you know. And then I watch how they spend it at the Holy Land Experience. Oh, my goodness. Business and finance. Psychological counseling. That has replaced biblical teaching. Even in the church, seminaries and Bible colleges, the departments of counseling and psychology have become bigger than the majors in missions and pastoring.
Yes.
We had a guy come from a Christian college to our church in Orlando. He was going to do a seminar on marriage. And I'm looking for him to open to Ephesians 5 and other passages like that. We went through two sessions. Never once did he open the Bible or even refer to it. I took him aside and I said, "Hey, brother, you came here from a Christian college, and I'm expecting you to teach the Word of God." Oh, the Word of God doesn't have all the answers, you know, he's telling me. And I said, "Well, I think our seminar is done. We're not going to have any more of this foolishness."
Amen. Amen.
And I'm thinking, wow, we've got Nicolaitanism in the church. Churches have become so big, they have to have lifestyle facilities and all sorts of things and big, you know, big staff and, you know, facilities, and now they got a big monster and they got to keep feeding it, so they're big on the money, you know. I mean, it just gets to be outlandish, you know.
Yeah.
And you talk about music. Well, that's the elephant in the room, you know, the music. And I understand style and preference, you know. And I thoroughly enjoyed your music. But does the church understand the difference between the flesh and the spirit?
Yes, sir.
Does it appeal to the flesh or is it spiritual? Paul says in Galatians 5:17, the flesh wars against the spirit and the spirit against the flesh, and the two are contrary one to another, so you can't do the things you want to do. He says you either have one or you have the other. And so much of the church, it's not that I disagree with the music and the words may be good, but boy, I watched the lady in front of me just wiggling all over the place and jumping up and down. Man, she's really grooving on what's happening, and it doesn't appear to be anything spiritual going on.
Yeah.
Now, I don't mean to be making fun of all this, because it's serious stuff.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
The wisdom of men is replacing the wisdom of Christ. Sermons have been reduced to devotionals. And that's why we have a generation of biblical illiterates. Appalling lack of Bible knowledge among Christian people. And they have the audience mentality. They're not part of a body of Christ. They're part of an audience. And they either clap or boo, depending on what happens.
Wow. Yeah.
And then they leave. And there's been no change in their life.
Reverend.
Wow.
Reverend.
My goodness. Most Christians don't walk with Christ. They just go to church. Well, let's talk about the last part, because that's the good part. He says, if you'll overcome this and understand how important it is for you to be in the Word as a Christian person, for you to be walking with Jesus, not just going to church. It's a 24/7, 365 deal, you know. It's not just the hours you spend in the church. And it's all about your walk with Jesus. And you start doing that, and the church starts doing that, and you'll begin to have the power of God in your church and not just the image of God.
Yes, sir.
And he says, if you'll overcome, I've got something for you.
Yeah.
I've got a white stone.
Woo!
What's the deal with a white stone? That doesn't sound all that valuable. Give me some money, Lord. Lord, I got a white stone for you. Our Lord will not only take you to dinner, give you hidden manna, he'll also give you a precious stone that's very, very personal. How do you know the will of God? Well, there are two verses that are very parallel. They have the same sequence. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Don't lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. How does He direct your path? When you acknowledge Him in all of your ways. And you don't depend on your worldly way of thinking. Well, the parallels in Romans 12, 1 and 2. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, you present your body a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is the reasonable thing to do. And don't be conformed to this world. The word for world there is ion. It's not the word cosmos. This is the word ion. This is the word of philosophy. This is the word of ideas.
Yeah.
Don't be conformed to the way the world thinks, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may discover what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Don't ever be afraid of the will of God. It's good, and it's acceptable, and it's perfect for you. But don't be conformed to the way the world thinks. How do you know how to follow God's will? Well, you just get in the Word, and you get a transformed mind. So the old program is thrown away, and you get a new software, and you put it in so that when you plug into experiences, the new software ideas come up, and it's the Word of God. And you got a transformed mind. He says, well, I'll give you a white stone. Well, white stones were in common use in the ancient world, and it was a sense of goodwill and favor, and sometimes they'd split a stone, and it would be called a tessera hospitalis, and one had half the stone, the other half, you know how that goes, and just a lot of things happened with white stones. But what's the white stone here? Well, you got to know the context. You see, in chapter 1, Jesus is among the lampstand, which is the churches. He's walking among the churches. This is the high priest trimming the menorah, the lampstand. It's Moses talk. And manna was all about Moses stuff. Food given in Moses' day. So we're back there in that time. Is there a white stone we know of in that time? Well, yeah, there is. See, the high priest had a breastplate on, and it had 12 colored stones to represent the 12 tribes of Israel. And he bore them on his breast, just like Jesus bears the church on his heart.
Yeah.
But then there was a little bag inside, and there were two stones in that bag. One was a white stone, and the other was a black stone. A.W. Pink, in his book, he quotes D.R. Bullinger, and he says, the Urim and the Thummim were probably two precious stones which were drawn out as a lot to give Jehovah's judgment. Two stones in a bag on the breastplate, Urim, a diamond, and Thummim, an onyx. And the high priest wanted to know what God wanted them to do. He'd reach in, and the stones were just the same. Couldn't tell the feeling. They were smooth. And he'd pick out a stone. If it was a black stone, nope, don't do it. If it was a white stone, yes. This is what I want you to do. The white stone was his guidance. And you read about the Urim and the Thummim in Exodus 28. And a number of places, Numbers 27, 1 Samuel 28, they're on your notes. And it just refers to the Urim. It says, who stand before Eliezer the priest, who shall ask counsel for him after the judgment of the Urim before the Thummim. They didn't even mention the Thummim. And in 1 Samuel 28, they're looking for direction. Saul inquired of the Lord. The Lord answered him not, neither by dreams, nor by Urim, nor by prophets. Just mentions the Urim. That's just the white stone. And the white stone's the yes stone. And he says to us, I'm going to give you a white stone.
Yeah, wow.
It's the white stone he gives to those who overcome. It's the yes stone. Yeah. 2 Corinthians 1:20, for all the promises of God in him are yea, and in him amen, unto the glory of God. He's not telling you what he's not going to do. He's telling you what he's going to do.
Yes,
and he's going to lead you. That's the direction of God. I'm going to give you a white stone. God's direction for your life. But then it says more. It says, that stone I'll have a new name. God loved to do that, you know. Believers were given new names. Abram was called Abraham. Jacob was called Israel. Saul was called Paul. Cephas, Peter, was called Cephas. It became a new creation in Christ Jesus, and God gave him a new name. I'm kind of anxious to get there and find out what my new name is.
Yeah.
I already got a pretty good name. Daniel, God is judge. You know, that's not a bad name. But he's got to give me a new name. And he says, which nobody else will know but you. That's personal.
It's up.
Personal. He's saying, I'm going to give you personal direction. You're not going to depend on some hierarchy somewhere. Oh, you want to be taught the word, and that's the way pastors help you. You know, you got to listen and understand and grow in your knowledge of the word. But as you do, he said, you take that and you go and you live it, and I'm going to direct your life. I've got a plan for you. I've got something with your name on it, and nobody else knows but you, because this is for you.
Yes, sir.
Personal.
Personal.
Wisdom for life is found in Christ and His Word. And I can attest to the fact over the years of my life in ministry where I've been prone to trust the wisdom of the world and found it to be not good. And I come and I begin to depend on the Word of God. And it's wonderful. Wonderful. And I look for that. You know, before I ever came out here, Pastor Mark called me. And anytime anybody calls me and said, would you come and share the word with us? I say, give me a little time. Let me talk to the Lord about that. And I pray. And the Lord put it on my heart. Says, yeah, they're good people. I want you to go there. And I knew you. I've been here before. And I knew Pastor Mark. And they're good people. I want you to go there and encourage them with the word. And he put that in my heart. And that's all I needed. You folks are so generous. And you've been taking an offering. I mean, I tell people, I'll come for free. The Lord wants me to go somewhere. I'm just going. I drove 600 miles in a little old car out there to get here, and I'm going to drive 600 more miles tomorrow to get home. And that doesn't matter one bit, because the Lord wants me here. So that's all that matters to me, the direction of God in my life. I want His direction. And oh, if we'd all just catch that. Oh, what our churches would become. I don't need the wisdom of the world. I don't need to be in anybody's system. I don't need to be, you know, looking to the world for how to do stuff. I just go to the Word, and it is sufficient.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. All right.
I get the hidden manna. I'm fulfilled in Jesus.
Yes.
And I get a white stone with my name on it. I've got direction in Jesus. I've got dinner and a diamond. How can you beat that? Oh, I hope you're encouraged.
Yes, sir.
Oh, the promises of God are beautiful if we understand what He's saying. Let's pray together. And you take a moment. Let me not pray too quick, because you need to respond in your heart. God didn't give preachers the Bible just so you could hear sermons. The Bible was given to change our lives.
Yes, sir.
And it's all about the response that comes from you as to whether anything happens. And I know full well only the Spirit of God does that. So I've been praying, you know, the Lord would go beyond anything I do here, and He would touch your heart.
Yes, sir.
Say, oh, Lord Jesus, You are sufficient for my life. Lord Jesus, help me to know You better. Help me to walk with You every day. And then church begins to mean so much because you're walking with Jesus.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And you just pray and ask the Lord, oh, Spirit of God,
yes, sir,
rip me away from this old world. I know I got to live in it. I got to deal with it. But, oh, Lord, may my desire be for You. And you just pray for a moment, whatever decision you need. And if you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, oh, that's the first thing you got to know. Just confess that you're a sinner before God and say, oh, thank You, Lord Jesus, for dying on the cross for me, shedding Your blood for my sin. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Save me. And the authority of God's Word, the moment you pray that sinner's prayer, understanding with a humble heart and a sincere mind, He will save you on the spot and forgive your sin and give you eternal life. And you'll become His child, where you find fulfillment in Him and find your direction in His Word. You pray whatever is your prayer, that the Spirit of God will enable you to pray. Oh, gracious Father, these have been good nights. Oh, I have been so encouraged by Your people. Thank You for this church. Thank You for its leadership, for the commitment to Your Word and to the exaltation of the name of Jesus. Oh, what a wonderful time this has been. But, oh God, Your Word, when we open it and we study it, oh, we begin to see things, even in the lives we think are so good, that down deep there are things that aren't what they should be. Draw us to You. Draw us to Christ. And Father, these areas in which we need renovation, refocusing, oh Father, that by Your Spirit You would work a work in our hearts and change us to be more like Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Oh, Father, bless this fellowship and the other fellowships of pastors and people who are here. But, Father, Your power will rest upon them because they exalt the name of Jesus. Father, we'll be so grateful to You for Your work in our hearts and lives and our churches. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
First of all, do we have anyone to help? Let's take one question. Do we have a question about the payment? Do you want to have a question? Raise your hand, please. We know that the Holy Spirit is constantly continuing to minister to us. We truly thank God for this. Is what I and St. Luke pray for, a revival for the church, for someone to come and paint a pictorial picture of the body of Christ, baptized believers, and to evaluate us mentally and spiritually, what we are, what we're doing. Now, we allow the world to mold us and to shape us. When we come to church, what do we come for? What stimulates us when we walk into the presence of God? Is God pleased with us? Are we looking for a show of peace and excitement? Dr. Hayden, God spoke directly to you in these messages. This is what St. Luke wanted. And St. Luke, I am so proud of you. Our officers out doing devotion, Al on the video. I'm just so proud of a church where people's quality.